Good morning, Bell Road. Good morning. Our amazing church has given us the opportunity to lead you all in worship this morning. Today we are celebrating Resurrection Day, so if you guys want to stand up, we're going to give the glory to God.
Glory to God! Praise the Lord!
Amen.
Amen, Miss Jean.
The King who conquered the grave.
Forever, one day is coming, oh glory. How's everybody today?
Great.
Good. So, before I start off with mine, I just wanted to say thank you to everyone in this church today, and thank you for the people who visited. I wanted to say thank you for giving all of us the opportunity to be able to, share our word and our perspective. But this is a very important day. And so, when you think of Easter, you think, well, obviously the resurrection. But let's go back to the Last Supper, okay? So, we start off before the Last Supper, before they have their dinner. Jesus told the 12 people that one of them was going to betray him. Matthew 26:21 says, "They're all eating. Then Jesus said, 'I tell you the truth, one of you 12 will turn against me.'" Now, here's something funny. Here's something interesting. Jesus wasn't actually seated in the middle of the table. He was seated at the end of the table, and to his right was John, and to his left was Judas. The seat that Judas sat in was the seat for a guest of honor, and Jesus puts Judas there, knowing that he was going to betray him. And he says in Scripture that it will be you that will betray me. In my perspective, this teaches us that to honor and bless those that curse you. Matthew 26:27, then Jesus took a cup, he thanked God for it, and gave it to the followers. He said, "Every one of you drink this. This is my blood, which begins the new agreement that God makes with his people. This blood is poured out for many to forgive their sins." Before Jesus was crucified, he felt anxiety. He was fearful. He cried out to the Lord multiple times, "Why have you forsaken me?" Matthew 26:38-39 says, he said to Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, "My heart is full of sorrow and breaking with sadness. Stay here with me and watch." Then Jesus walked a little farther away from them. He fell to the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, do not give me this cup of suffering, but do what you want, not what I want." That's something that we have to say every day, because if you take it into real life, sometimes we have to do things the hard way. And we need to do what God wants us to do, not what we feel. That's our gut. That's our gut, by the way. I do want to mention that before Jesus was crucified, the first word that he spoke on the cross was, "Father, forgive them. They do not know what they are doing." The first thing uttered from Jesus was forgiveness. He's being beat and put on this cross, but he's forgiving. Just like we should show forgiveness and love to people in our life, no matter how they treat us. I do want to add a little bit of a personal touch before I move it on to the next person. There is small story I would like to share. A lot of you in this room know, but my dog passed away back in December, and it was really hard to deal with it. But the way that I want to connect this is that Jesus died on the cross so that we are able to be forgiven of our sins, and I can go up and see that dog that I lost. I can go up to heaven and cross that rainbow bridge with him. Because Jesus died on the cross. And anything, our sins are forgiven, and we are forgiven, and we are able to walk the beautiful gardens of heaven all together because Jesus died on the cross for us. That's my piece.
How y'all doing this morning? Miss Tracy wants to do a little icebreaker, so I didn't know how to get into this icebreaker without saying that. What do y'all imagine when I say bourbon? Most people think of a stone on your back or something holding you down. As one of my favorite artists, as y'all know, I've spoken with him numerous times, NF, he pictures them as balloons. Not because they're easy, or because they hold you down, but because you can let go at any moment. He goes, but you have to fully let go of that willing for God to take it from you and actually help you. And I've also said, I don't live for the world, I live for the King. And thank the Lord, I serve a God that's perfect. In Mark 8:35, he said, for whosoever will save his life shall lose it. But for so who loses his life, forsaken for the gospel, the same shall save it. Saying we should not work our life to what is earthly, but to grow a relationship with the Lord himself and grow closer to him. In my scripture, I'm going to talk about the life of Jesus, mostly the last week he had before he was crucified. In the beginning, this is Mark 1:1, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ and the Son of God. Jesus the Messiah, the Son of God, whose death and resurrection paid the penalty for our sins and achieved victory over Satan, sin, and death. It is not our good deeds that will get us to heaven. It is not what we do that will get us to heaven. It is our belief that will get us to heaven. Jesus even got baptized, but Jesus was perfect. He lived perfectly, so he had no need to be baptized. But baptism isn't the only thing that gets you. You have to believe in that baptism and believe in the Lord to get you there. Because Jesus, as he was nailed to the cross in Luke 23:43, he said, truly, I say to you today, you will be with me in paradise. That thief was never baptized. He never went and did charity or tried to change his life around, but he said he believed in the Lord, and that was enough to get him through with him. Mm-hmm. That is the strong part of baptism, I believe. It's not just saying, I want to be baptized. You also have to have the belief behind it and the knowledge behind the Lord himself. In Mark 16:20, they said, and went forth, and they preached everywhere, and the Lord, working with them, and confirmed the word of signs and following. I close this sermon to say that we should all go forth in the world and preach the Lord and have the Lord by our side.
Amen.
To start in with mine, I'll just get right into it. It says, well, each gospel gave us a variety of details. One thing remains consistent throughout, and that is, as the women made their way to the tomb, they had just one question in their mind. Who will roll the stone for us? It was a very large stone that would have taken 20 men to roll it away, given what we know about tombs at that time. So these three women knew they didn't stand a chance. They wanted to anoint their beloved Savior's body. It would be their last act of love for the one who showed them such love. But how? Apparently, they were not thinking about whether the guards would let them approach the tomb. They didn't seem worried about being arrested as a follower of Jesus. They weren't wondering why Peter and the others weren't joining them. They weren't even concerned with how they would react to seeing Jesus' body, their Savior, crucified and laying in the tomb. Resurrection Sunday means many things to us Christians. It's too big a miracle to mean just one thing. Clearly, we know this means that Christ is risen, it means that Jesus has defeated death, and it means that eternal life is real. But death does not enter a life of God, and all those who believe in him will not perish, but have ever-living life. But that stone being rolled away from the tomb, which is a detail recording all four of the Gospels, tells us something else about this day that is quite significant. The stone being rolled away tells us about the way in which God removes obstacles in our lives. Those obstacles that try to keep us from God and trying to stop us from living the life that God has called us to live. Today I want you to think about the large stone in your life, the obstacles that are keeping you from living a fulfilled life with Christ. here and now. Think about those challenges that are keeping you in your tomb, so to speak. Those battles that paralyze us with fear and trap us and try to stop us from living, really living our new lives in Christ. Our risen Lord enters our lives and even our tombs and rolls away the stones that are keeping us from being all that God wants us to be. He frees us from fear and helps to proclaim his message to the world. And I want to take like a second to really look back on where it talks about the stones and how the obstacles in your life. I went through a really hard time, which really showed me how God works and how he is truly there. Because before I went through that, like I knew he was there, but I didn't know how he truly worked. And I think going through that rough time truly showed me the miracles that he can make and what he truly does, which has led me to the reason that I really wanted to be baptized today, knowing how he works and wanting to be a part of it.
Good morning, everybody. How are we doing today? So I got something really cool to talk about today. How many of you know about the cloth that covered Jesus' face?
What?
Cool. So I get to teach you guys. Alright, so the Gospel of John, chapter 20, verses 6 and 7 says, Simon Peter arrived and went inside. He also noticed that the linen wrappings lying there, he also noticed the linen wrappings lying there, while the cloth that covered Jesus' face was folded up and lying apart from the other wrappings. So, what's the importance of that? Why was it folded up? Why was it lying separately from the other wrappings? And in order to understand why that's important, we have to look at Hebrew tradition in that day. So, back then, they had, you know, the masters and they had the servants, right? The servants would come out and set the table for the master. He would put out the plates, he'd put out the knives, he'd put out the forks, whatever utensils they used, he'd put out the napkin. And the master would come and eat his meal, and when he was done, he would take the napkin, wipe his face, wipe his beard, clear everything off, wad it up, set it to the side, and get up. And then by that, the servant would know that he was done with his food. But if the master instead took his napkin, folded it up neatly, and set it beside his plate, that he was not done. He was going to come back and finish his meal. So the significance of, you know, the cloth on Jesus' face, instead of being just wadded up and thrown with the other linens, being carefully folded and placed on the stone, it means that he was coming back. And the cool thing about that is, well, to apply this to my life, I have to tell you guys about my aunt. So recently, about a year ago, she was diagnosed with skin cancer. She eventually got over that, but about a month ago, they found out that she had like 4 or 5 tumors in her brain. She had brain cancer. So the other week I went up to say my last goodbyes to her. And, you know, I was torn up. Like, I was torn up like anybody would be. Perfect timing. No, but seriously. But at the same time, I had peace because I knew that I would see her again, that Jesus would come back and bring her back, and I would see her. And on that day, I would be the happiest man alive because, man, I love my aunt to death. So I hope you all can remember that he's coming back
He's going to bring a whole army with him, and it's going to be wonderful.
Again, this is Luke 22 to 24. Are we ready? Okay. So we are going to start in the betrayal and arrest of Jesus. We are going to start in Luke 22:47. While he was speaking, a crowd came, and Judas, who was one of the 12, was leading them. Judas came near to give him a kiss, and Jesus said, "Judas, would you betray the Son of Man with a kiss?" When Jesus' followers saw what was going to happen, they said, "Lord, should we strike with our swords?" One of them struck the servant and cut off his right ear. Jesus said, "No more of this." He touched and healed the man. Jesus then said to everyone who had come for him, "Am I leading a rebellion that you have come with swords and clubs? Every day I was with you in the temple courts, and you did not lay a hand on me. But this is your hour when darkness reigns." They seized him and brought him to the high priest's house. Peter was following at a distance. They kindled a fire in the center of the courtyard, and they all sat down together, and Peter sat among them. A servant girl looked closely at him and stated, "This man was also with him." Peter denied this by saying, "Woman, I do not know him." After a little while, someone else recognized him and said, "You also are one of them." Peter replied, "Ma'am, I'm not." After about an hour later, another insisted, saying, "Certainly this man also was with him, for he too is a Galilean." Peter still replied, "Ma'am, I do not know what you were talking about." While he was speaking, a rooster crowed. Jesus looked at Peter, and he immediately remembered what the Lord had said to him, "Before the rooster crows today, you will deny me 3 times. He went out and he wept. Jesus was held in custody, and he was mocked as he was being beaten. Jesus was blindfolded, and they kept asking him, "Prophesy, who is it that struck you?" They were saying many things and blaspheming him. When the day came, the elders of the people gathered together, both scribes and chief priests. They led him to their council, and they said, "If you are the Christ, tell us." He said to them, "If I tell you, you will not believe, and if I ask you, you will not answer. But from now on, the Son of Man shall be seated at the right hand of the power of God." They all said, "Are you the Son of God then?" He said to them, "You say that I am." When they said, "What further testimony do we need? We have heard it ourselves from his own lips." So now we are going to jump to Luke 23, 1 through 5, and we are going to read those verses. It says, "Then the whole assembly rose and led him off to Pilate. And they began to accuse him, saying, 'We have found this man subverting our nation. He opposes payment of taxes to Caesar and claims to be Christ, a king.' So Pilate asked Jesus, 'Are you the king of the Jews?' 'Yes, it is as you say,' Jesus replied. Then Pilate announced to the chief priests and the crowd, 'I find no basis for a charge against this man.' But they insisted, 'He stirs up the people all over Judea by his teaching. He started in Galilee and has come all the way here.'" So in this passage, it's talking about how Jesus was not found guilty, but later on it shows that the people had such an urgency to get rid of him for stirring up the people. So, Pilate sent Jesus to Herod, who had been wanting to see signs from Jesus. Herod became friends with Pilate, and Jesus was sent back to Pilate, being deemed, again, not guilty. Pilate chose to punish him, then release him. Everyone was still crying out, away with this man, and release us to Barabbas, a man who had been thrown into prison for an insurrection started in the city and for murder. Pilate desired to release Jesus, but they kept shouting, "Crucify! Crucify him!" Pilate still pushed to punish him and release him, as he saw no guilt deserving death. They still cried for crucifixion. Pilate finally decided that their demand should be granted. That's not that great. It made me sad writing this, guys. He released Barabbas, who they requested to be set free, and they took Jesus in his place. Jesus was led away, and they seized Simon of Cyrene, who was coming in from the country, and laid on him the cross to carry it behind Jesus. A great multitude of the people and the women who were mourning and lamenting for them. You know, they lamented for him. Yeah. Sorry, I'm stuttering a lot now. But turning to them, Jesus had said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For behold, the days are coming when they will say, 'Blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bore, and the bosoms that never nursed.' Then they will begin to say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if they do these things when the wood is green, what will happen when it is dry?" Two others, who were criminals, were led away to be put to death with him. When they came to the place called the Skull, where they were crucified, one criminal was on his left, and the other was on his right. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." They cast lots to divide his garments. Many stood by watching, but the ruler scoffed and said, "He saved others. Let him save himself. If he is the Christ of God, his chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." Sorry, I lost my place. There we go. There was an inscription above him saying, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who were with him said to him, "Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us." The other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we are receiving the due reward of our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." And he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus said to him, "Truly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise."
Yeah.
Perfect timing. It was the sixth hour, and it was dark until the ninth hour, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, calling out with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." Having said this, he breathed his last. When the centurion saw what had taken place, he praised God, saying, "Certainly this man was innocent." All the crowds had assembled, looking at this spectacle, and when they saw what had happened, they returned home. His acquaintances and the women who had followed him from Galilee stood, and they watched from a distance. Joseph went to Pilate and asked for Jesus' body. He wrapped it in linen and laid him in a tomb cut in stone where no one had been laid before. The women from Galilee followed, and when they returned, they prepared spices and ointment. They rested on the Sabbath as the commandment had directed. On the first day of the week, at early dawn, they went to the tomb, but the stone was rolled away from the door. They went in and did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. They were perplexed. There we go. And behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. They were frightened and bowed their heads. The men said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen."
Amen.
Amen. "Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified and on the third day rise." They remembered his words, and returning from the tomb, they told this to the 11 and all the rest. It was Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary, the mother of James, and the other women with them, who told these things to the apostles. These things seemed like idle tales, but they didn't believe them. They didn't believe them at all. Peter rose, and he ran to the tomb, stooping and looking in. He saw the linen cloths by themselves, and he went home, marveling at what had happened. As they were talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace to you." They were frightened and thought they saw a spirit. So he said, "Why are you troubled? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? See my hands and my feet? That it is I myself. Touch me and see. For a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." They were still disbelieving. He asked if they had anything to eat, and they gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he ate. He then said, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." He opened their minds to understand the scriptures. He said to them, "Thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance for the forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you. But stay in the city until you are clothed with the power from on high." He led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. While he blessed them, he parted from them, and was carried up into heaven. And they worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and were continually in the temple blessing God. So today, I ask of you to lay down your burdens and be thankful for the scars. Now, I would like to invite Emily and Dane to go ahead and start getting ready for their baptism. Yay!
I'm going to be reading Luke 22, 1 through 46. It says, "Now the feast of unleavened bread drew near, which is called the Passover, and the chief priests and scribes were seeking how to put him to death, for they feared the people. Then Satan entered into Judas called Iscariot, who was of the number of the 12. He went away and conferred with the chief priests and officers how he might betray him to them. And they were glad and agreed to give him money. So he consented and sought an opportunity to betray him to the absence of the crowd." So basically, they all just want to kill Jesus. And even though a lot of them probably knew who he was, they just did not like that. And so they wanted to get rid of him. Says, "Then came the day of unleavened bread, which on the Passover lamb, which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. So Jesus sent Peter and John, saying, 'Go and prepare Passover for us, that we may eat it.' They said to him, 'For whom you have us prepared?' He said to them, 'Behold, when you have entered the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him into the house that he enters, and tell the master of the house, "The teacher says to you, where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? And he will show you a large upper room furnished, and prepare it there.' And they went and found it just as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover. And when the hour came, he reclined at the table, and the apostles with him. And he said to them, 'I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God.' And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he said,
Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you that from now on I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." So that is our communion. That's always been an important part of Jesus's life. And I believe there's a table right down there that says, "Do this in remembrance." Cannot say that word today. Remembrance of me. And likewise, the cup after they had eaten, saying, "This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. But behold, the hand of him who betrays me is with me on the table. For the Son of Man goes as it has been determined. But woe to the man by whom he is betrayed." And they began to question one another, "Which of them could it be who is going to do this?" A dispute also arose among them as to which of them it was to be regarded as the greatest. And he said to them, "The kings of the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and those in authority over them are called benefactors. But not so with you. Rather, let the greatest among you become as the youngest, and the leader as one who serves. For who is the greater one who reclines at the table or one who serves? Is it not the one who reclines at the table? But I am among you as the one who serves. You are those who have stayed with me in my trials, and I assign to you as my Father assigned to me, a kingdom, that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom and sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Simon, Simon, behold, Satan demanded to have you. That is, that he might sift you like wheat. But I have prayed for you that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned again, strengthen your brothers." Peter said to him, "Lord, I'm ready to go with you both to prison and to death." Jesus said, "I tell you, Peter, the rooster will not crow to this day. The rooster will not crow this day until you deny three times that you know me." Which, as we all know, that happened. And he said to them, "When I sent you out with no money bag or knapsack or sandals, did you lack anything?" They said, "Nothing." He said to them, "But now let the one who is a money bag take it, and likewise a knapsack. And let the one who has no sword sell his cloak and buy one. For I tell you that the scripture must be fulfilled in him." And he was numbered with the transgressors. "For it is written about me has its for what is written about me has its fulfillment." And they said, "Look, Lord, here are two swords." And he said to them, "It is enough." And he came out and went as was his custom to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. And when he came to the place, he said to them, "Pray that you may not enter into temptation." And he withdrew from them about a stone's throw and knelt down and started praying. "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done." And there appeared to him an angel from heaven, strengthening him. And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down from his body to the ground. And when he rose from prayer, he came to the disciples and found them sleeping for a sorrow. And he said to them, "Why are you sleeping? Rise and pray that you may not enter temptation."
Milwaukee. It's just wonderful to hear young people read scripture and apply it to their lives. You hear so many bad things about our youth, but I'm thankful. Today we're having two testimonies in baptism. Baptism doesn't save you, but it's their personal testimony. And the reason that we baptize is because Jesus' last words, his very last words on earth before he ascended into heaven, he said, "All authority in heaven and on earth is given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things I've commanded, and lo, I'm with you even to the end of the world." And so, coming first is Emily Faith Taylor. And this is her testimony. She wanted to share a few words before we do the baptism.
Thank you. As many of you might know, like, I have two different people in my life that unfortunately could not be here today. One being my aunt's father. He wanted to be the one to baptize both me and my brother. And so I do want to kind of give this to him in a way, because this was something special that he wanted. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, he can't have. So I still want this to be special for him and also my grandmother. She means a lot to me. She wanted to be there when both me and my brother got baptized, but she passed away before I had the chance to invite her. So I know she's up there watching, and it means a lot that she gets that for our team. So.
This is Emily Faith Taylor. Emily, in obedience to the commands of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and upon your confession of faith in Jesus as your Savior and Lord, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Baptism, risen to walk.